In a world of boring talk, misinformation, and mindless chatter, two superheroes emerge from the ashes. Ashes.
Ben, is this asses or ashes?
Bring the action.
Happy hour with Ben and Alexander.
Pull up a chair.
Raise a glass.
Enjoy it in the chat.
It's talk radio with jazz hands.
Oh my God, you had to say that.
Yes.
World nominated.
With chops. I mean, you have heard her voice everywhere, and you may not even realize it, but damn.
Laura Dickinson.
What is going on? And we get to play some of her music at the end of the show tonight.
Sneak peek of her new CD, One for My Baby.
Yeah, buddy.
But she provides a lot of singing voices for all the shows on Disney.
Absolutely.
Phineas and Ferb, Sophia the First, Jake.
She's every 9-year-old girl's favorite artist, yeah. Right?
And usually when you meet somebody who does voiceover work, you're like, woof, because they have this beautiful
voice.
And then you meet them in real life, and they're just like,
really?
This vixen walks in today.
Wah,
wah. Wah, wah. I'm just drawn that way.
You're just drawn that way?
That's what Jessica Rabbit says.
Okay.
Not that I play Jessica Rabbit.
Not at all.
My bedroom.
LARPing,
to myself.
Live action role play over here.
Please, Eddie.
No.
Hello. Laura Dickinson, put on your headphones. You're a voiceover artist. Don't you know?
And we're back with the showers. We were.
She's all schooling us when the show's starting out. She's like, what? I have to do what?
All right, Kirk, let's just go ahead and bring her on. Here we go.
The best is yet to come, and babe, won't it be fine? The best is yet to come. Come the day of mine.
We are live from Sunset Gower Studios here in the heart of Hollywood. The boys of Happy Hour are proud to present that lovely lady at the mic, actress and Broadway World nominee, Laura Dickinson!
Yeah, buddy!
I'm obsessed with this woman and her
How
amazing
How are
voice.
You?
I'm great. Thank you for asking.
Absolutely.
How are you?
I'm brilliant. Thank you so much.
When people actually meet you after like having hired you for your voice, are they surprised that you're so gorgeous?
What is that supposed to mean?
Because I told you, most of the times it's like, whoa, 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 Nellie.
You're so nice.
Not usually.
At least she's honest about it.
Obsessed with your voice. I had the opportunity to, I've seen you a few times perform. You played Bobby, the male part in Company. And it was, you got to sing Being Alive. I mean, these just, your voice just blew me away. Then last night we listened to your version of A Holy Night on YouTube.
Wow.
Wow. Wow.
Like Judy got out from the grave. She's like, oh my, that was wonderful. And then she went back. And then
so
you have
weird.
The CD coming out. You provided the voices for so many Disney shows in fun, Phineas and Ferb, mm-hmm. Sophia the First, Jake, and the Neverland Pirates.
Did you know that? Did you know that you
did?
Not?
I did.
I'm so excited.
I just did a new one called The 7D, too. That was really fun. There's some really big voiceover names on that show that I was like, oh, I'm working with Bill Farber and Maurice LaMarche.
Wow.
I've arrived.
But what is it? When you go into the booth, are you guys all in there to know? Is it?
No, I'm always alone.
Really?
People ask me all the time, so how is it working with Ashley Tisdale? I'm like, never met her.
And you do the singing voice for Tori Spelling and what's her face?
Tiffany Thiessen.
Yeah, her. But you never get to interact with them?
Nope. I just listen to their talking a lot and try and sound like I would be singing like them.
What is, I mean, is that, how, do you, so you have to just listen to them over and over and then kind of gauge a tone of their voice and then?
Yeah, you sort of hear where they're talking and you pitch your voice to, because that's why I love doing what I do, because mm-hmm. the talking, every word you speak can be equated to a note, so I find musically where they speak and talk up there and then just start singing like that.
Oh, that's
it's kind
that's
of
crazy.
A weird process, but
that's fun.
I did Rango. I don't know if you noticed.
Yes, yes you did.
I did Rango, but when we did it, everybody was in the room together. We all had costume pieces.
Oh wow.
And when he was ready to have us speak together, he would usher us over and we were all like around batons speaking into mics. But at one point he said to Johnny, I think you need to come over here and do so and so and so and so, like blah, blah, blah. And Johnny looks up at him and goes, isn't this animated? I saw that.
The special feed. That was a great process.
We were so lucky there. I mean, I did also Babe.
Babe, you were the sheep.
I was one of the sheep. I don't get to do other stuff. I mean, I have a wonderful voiceover agent who, God bless him for keeping me. I think I've done like 3 or 4 things in my 18,000 years with them. So you have a specialty. I don't know if you guys appreciate
what it is.
She has a fabulous voice listening, but to do what she does is mm-hmm. another incredible. Everybody cannot do that. Big C-A-N-N-O-T cannot do what she does.
That's very kind of you. Thank you. I got it from my dad. He was a professional Elvis impersonator.
Really?
He was?
Well, yeah. He did all of these classic rock people, Elvis, Roy Orbison, John Fogerty, and he could morph his voice into sounding like anybody, and I just kind of listened to him and grew up and did it.
Yes, you did. You did it big time.
And now we don't speak.
Oh, damn.
I just had this flash. Maybe you and I should do the Patsy Cline thing together.
Oh, I love that show.
Sally Struthers would hire a hit person.
Oh, God.
I know. Well, I could hire a more vicious one.
But I could do a good Patsy.
Well,
sure.
See, that's on Honey. I can be that other person that came over there. You won't believe Patsy Cline here for me today. So, oh, my God.
You heard it here first.
There we go, folks.
You could produce it. I just thought you guys could be the producers.
I'll stay in the back and drink.
That's kind of what the producer did.
Well, how do you keep your voice healthy? Because you're belting one night, then you're doing
You're in the studio every day, aren't you?
That's a great question. People ask me that all the time. It's like the Olympics. If you train and if you keep doing it and you do it every day and you invest the hours and the time, your voice is, it's a muscle. It'll respond mm-hmm. the way you want it to. And I just take it like these taffy pulling jobs that they put me through, and it just holds up. And I've actually become quite fond of learning how to sing and when I'm sick. And I just kind of, it's fun for me to be like, oh, I'm sick. I sound different. And ooh, how do I get around that?
Smelly cat, smelly cat.
But it's taking care of your health. I know when I don't sleep. Mm-hmm. That's the only thing really that, and you asked about that video of One for My Baby that we put on YouTube, the cut on the album, we filmed it. And I had to, that's an interesting story I'll tell real quick. I did a show in Sacramento for the same people that produce Music Circus, that they're smaller, and it was called My Way, a tribute to Frank Sinatra. And we had this great little venue and 3 other really, really talented actors that are great friends of mine and a pianist and Frank Sinatra tribute show. And I ended up having to go on and sing One for My Baby for the lead guy because he was sick.
Oh, damn.
And I ended up just falling in love with that song, and I loved the way the pianist and I worked together, and the guy that wrote the arrangements for that show, I ended up looking him up on YouTube, and he's this like Rachmaninoff of the instrument, and he just plays like no one I've ever seen. I'm like, I have to work with this guy. I messaged him. He came to California and recorded that track with me. And that's the title track, the end track of the album, One for My Baby, just me and a pianist. And I loved it. And I did it probably 4 years ago, and it inspired this whole project. But my engineer lost the original track.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Yes, I was trying to be gracious. But the pianist, his name's Vince Demura, he teaches at Princeton, and he's a marvelous human being. But he lives in New York, in New Jersey. So I flew to New York. I took a red eye because my only day off, I'm like, I got to go record this song. And I didn't sleep. And my face broke out and my voice was like so tired. But I ended up being able to pull it off by some miracle. But that's really the only thing that gets hard, is if you don't sleep, you just don't rest your instrument. But I do all the weird things like a teaspoon of coconut oil in the morning and apple cider vinegar and try and stay healthy. The oregano oil and, you know, the neti pots, sinus rinse.
Oh, God, you do those?
Well, the squeeze bottle, the sinus rinse is easier than pouring it and kinking your neck to the side. Yeah, you might like it. It gets fun after a few times.
Especially when you have that little booger up here.
Well, there she goes.
There she goes.
It's gratifying. It opens everything up.
I can breathe again.
But how do you psychologically prepare, because you sing so many different genres? Like, you've opened for Tony Bennett, you've opened mm-hmm. for Lyle Lovett, and then you've done like old standards like the Frank Sinatra, then you do musical theater, and then you do the Phineas and Ferb, which is kind of, that can be anywhere from like a rock song to like a techno song to like a ballad. How do you, like, okay, this is what I'm doing today?
Gosh, thanks for noticing. Huh. It's just, I love singing. And I've been doing it my whole life, literally. I started training as a dancer, believe it or not, when I was three. And I did my first recording session when I was five.
Wow.
And so I just, it's kind of like I live and breathe it. And I love all kinds of music. And I just, it just comes naturally to me. So
that's when you know you're doing what you're supposed to do, right?
Yeah, I'm having a good time.
Yeah.
When you opened for Tony Bennett, was he in your dressing room before, like trying to boop, boop?
Nope, never met him. Smiled across the lawn and waved.
Are you serious?
Nope.
And that's show business, kid.
It was a burlesque type of a show, and I was the featured singer, and I had, I think, 8 dancers with me, and it was really a cool show. I had to dance a lot, too. But we just came on and opened for him, and then he came out later, and they were tuning his piano in the background while we were doing our sound check, and I saw him across the lawn. And I'm like, hey. It was at the Bel Air Hotel. He's like, hi. I'm like, hello. I love you.
But right now you've actually got some projects that you're working on, correct?
Your new CD, which I'm so excited. One for My Baby. Mm-hmm. Frank Sinatra songs. When does it release? How can I get it?
It releases on December 12th, which is Frank Sinatra's birthday. And everybody, all my colleagues are like, you're stupid to release it at Christmas time. I'm like, I'm releasing on Frank Sinatra's birthday. Hello.
And it's the best gift to give to somebody.
Thank you. It's his 99th birthday. So in preparation for the centennial next year, I loved making it. And I produced it myself. I started my own record label. I hired all the musicians, hired the musician contractor, called on the phone, booked all the studios, hired all the arrangers. So it was a really big learning experience for me. I went around and looked at all the people that I knew were doing it right, like Gordon Goodwin and his band, and I picked out my favorite arrangers and just called them myself and tried to be personal about it and say, look, here's what I'm doing, and I'm one of the few girls I know in this town that's leading her own band and doing something like this, so would you help a sister out?
I think that is, if you want something done, sometimes you have to do it yourself. And it was it your first time actually ever like taking on something like that, to creatively do it all?
It was, and it was cool because all of my voiceover stuff and my musician stuff, I've been in the studio a lot, so I knew how to do it. I just had to just morph it and apply it to me being the artist and the producer at the same time and running all the musicians in the studio. They were all those guys were so shocked to see a girl telling them what to do, but
the
it
boss.
Was so fun.
It's the future.
It was fun. I had a great time, and I've gotten some really good feedback on the album, and it's available on pre-order on iTunes right now.
One for My Baby. I think we're flashing up the CD cover now. What I like about, because I've been able to hear a few sneak peeks, you've really made the music your own. You're not just trying to recreate what he did. You're really putting this new personality and arrangements. You're like, God, I know that song. And it's so entrancing.
Thank you.
I guess
Thank
you would
you.
Say.
That was the idea. We wanted to. I actually did one of Frank's original arrangements by Marty Paich. You know him as David Paich from Toto's dad. And we just took the exact arrangement and recreated it. And I wanted to have a nice happy medium of a solid tribute, but for the modern day and kind of fresh. And I'm hoping to attract a whole new audience because, boy, this generation needs some classic great American songbook.
Yes.
So thank you for that. I'm glad it's coming across. It's got a bunch of random stuff on it, and I really also wanted to make an album that actual musicians would like to hear, because there's a lot of dreck out in the music world right now. I have a song that's just electric bass and vocal that I arranged. I have a song that's just guitar and voice, and then one for My Baby is just piano and voice. But then there's the other tracks are full big band and strings. And you don't really hear that a lot anymore.
The energy behind that kind of stuff is just insane. And I think we're actually going to... Are we going to play a little?
We're going to finish our show out with Indian Summer. Where can our listeners keep track of you? Twitter?
You can find me on the interwebs. I'm on Twitter and Instagram at ElsieLaura, ElsieLaura, and on Facebook at Laura Dickinson and LauraDickinson.com. I have been instructed to separate my artist career and my voiceover career. So now I have lauradickinson.com and lauradickinsonvo.com. So it's a brand new adventure.
Buddy.
All right, we'll stick around. We'll let you introduce Indian Summer. We're gonna hear Indian Summer. Tell us a little bit about the process for this.
This is a Sammy Nestico arrangement. And a lot of times people these days in the studio to save money and to kind of micromanage the music a little bit. And it's a great thing. Sometimes they'll have the bass and the piano and the drums all record at once. Then they have all the horns come in and record at once. Then they have the strings come in and record at once. Well, we decided to do this particular cut everybody at the same time. And there's kind of a magical feeling to it because the band is having fun because they don't usually get to go in the studio with the whole band there. So we had a really, really good time. It was very early in the morning and we filmed it. So here it is.
Awesome. Yeah, thank you, Kurt. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Patrika Darbo. Thank you, Laura Dickinson.
And you got everyone. Enjoy. And then until next time, have a good one.
Begin the scene.